Crash Bandicoot is a platformer released for the Sony PlayStation in 1996. Made by Naughty Dog and skyrocketing them from a small company to a household name, Crash Bandicoot spawned one of the most successful series for the PlayStation and became somewhat of an unofficial mascot for the console, despite Sony not creating or being involved with the character. The series has definitely taken a downfall ever since Naughty Dog stopped being involved with it, but it's still a cultural icon of a generation and has appeared in many, many games of all shapes and sizes. But going back to the original game, you play as Crash Bandicoot, an anthropomorphic bandicoot with attitude who has escaped the laboratory of mad scientist Neo Cortex, who takes part in many controversial animal experiments to take over the world. Left behind, though, was a very attractive bandicoot known as Tana, and now Crash must go back and fight the other experimented animals in his quest to return his luscious lady. Seriously though, what is the matter with her design compared to Crash, or for that matter, any other bandicoot in the series? It's kind of unsettling really when you look back at it. Okay, no one actually cares about the plot of a platformer about a dancing Australian mammal. So as silly as it may be, we are here to play a video game. When you start a game, you're given a very basic options of starting a new game, loading from a save file, loading from a password since I guess not everyone had a memory card, and your basic sound options. No major thrills here, so let's just jump into the action. Whether you choose to load a save or start a new game, you'll be transferred to an overworld. Well, it's not really an overworld. It looks like one, but it's really just a straight line of stage after stage with the aesthetic of an overworld. The stages vary from several recurring settings like a jungle, factory, temple, snowfield, and laboratories. The first flaw of the game actually comes here. Unlike the later games in the trilogy, Crash 1 stages don't feel that varied from one another. Some of it is the aesthetic variation, with many stages feeling just like a harder version of a previous one with no real difference in feel, but some of it is also because of the lack of gameplay variety. The later entries in the series had many different diversions from the main gameplay, with jetpacks, hoverboarding, cycling, diving, whatever. In the first game, you have one or two stages where you ride a goat, with Crash giving a nightmare-fueling stare before doing so. And that's it, really. So yeah, the game doesn't stray very far from its core gameplay, but how is that core gameplay, really? Well, the game came out when 3D platforming was still a new thing, and developers were trying all sorts of different approaches to it. There were games like Mario 64, which used the open-endedness of 3D platforming and made it more of a free game to play, but some games like Crash Bandicoot took a more typical approach by taking a side-scroller and basically moving it up. It's a classic-style platformer in all ways, but just went an added direction or two. Surprisingly enough, I feel the simplicity of it works for the game's favor by giving it a very unique feel from most platformers back then. Each stage has a simple goal, get to the end. There are some side quests that became a staple for the Crash series, like collecting gems and breaking boxes, but for the most part, you're just moving from A to B. The neat thing, though, is how you get to the end of the stage. You usually just move forward and dodge everything, in a very obstacle course-like manner, but oftentimes, they use the fact that this is a 3D game and break up the motion by changing the direction, or making it fixed to a 2D plane, or heck, even move into the screen to avoid the occasional moving boulder. This kind of action-centered, Indiana Jones platforming style is a thing that, for me at least, has always been the appeal of Crash games, in stark contrast to many of its slower, more exploration-based contemporaries. I guess that in some way, it's kind of similar to Sonic in that aspect. Well, it's not as speed-centered as the Blue Hedgehog, but compared to where the genre was heading, this was a very welcomed, fast-paced platformer. But when you just want to play for a few minutes. Throughout the development of the game, it was cleverly called Sonic's Ass Game, because when you're running, you're always looking at Crash's behind. Moving back to the actual game, the controls and movements are very basic. You move with the D-pad, jump with the X button, and spin attack with the square button. You can kill most enemies by either jumping on them or spin attacking them, but there are some of those that you can only hit with one or the other. The basic movements aren't necessarily bad, but they do give you very few options. The later Crash games gave you more abilities to learn, and while I can't knock a game down for an improved sequel, I do wish they would give you just a little more control of how you move. The D-pad is also a little bit problematic. This is a platformer with a lot of close jumps you need to pull off, and not having analog control in this 3D world for how you move hinders it quite a bit. You can only get hit once in the game unless you get a sentient mask which lets you take one extra hit, and they stack up to two. When you get to three masks, you become momentarily invincible, and then go back to two masks. Being able to get hit only once under normal circumstances and having inaccurate movement mean you will die. A lot. The game tries to counteract this by giving you a lot of extra lives, but it doesn't really help in soothing the frustration. Now comes my main problem with the game, and the single thing that, in my opinion, makes the game far worse for no reason than what it could have been. The save system. In some stages, you can find icons of Tana in the boxes, and if you find three of those, you get to a bonus stage, which, if you succeed in getting to the end of, lets you save the game or gives you a password. Now, this is already not the most intuitive way to save your game, but it has one truly fatal flaw. The bonus stages do not respawn. If you fail a bonus stage or just want to go back and save, you can't. There are some other bonus stage icons of Dr. Cortex's assistant and Brio that apparently do respawn and let you do a special kind of bonus stage. But I'll be damned if I could ever find all three in a level. I always seem to find two, at most, and I break every box that I can get my hands on. When you put these together with the fact that the controls aren't very responsive and the stages are much longer than old school 2D platformers, and you get at a game where you do some stages over and over and over again. Now, I'm not the best Crash player around, definitely not, but I did get through the other two PS1 games just fine with 100% completion, and I found myself wasting a tremendous amount of time doing the same stages here over and over again just to get to a stinking save point. Back on track, after every few levels, you fight a boss fight against one of Cortex's other experiments. Those include some series staples like Ripperoo, but most of them were left primarily in this game, like Papu Papu, Koala Kong, and Pinstripe Patoru. These are certainly clever, but generally serve very little challenge, Pinstripe in particular being a waste of a really cool concept by being exceptionally easy to beat. The presentation of the game is actually for the most part great. The graphical style for the era is great and still holds up, with a cartoony feel giving it a bit of a timeless quality on a console that isn't quite known for well-aged graphics. The colors all pop, and aside from some of the repetition, the stages all look great too. The music is pretty forgettable though. Besides the theme song, not a lot of it will get stuck in your head, which does give it a point drop in my book compared to most classic platformers. Overall, Crash Bandicoot is not the same game most people remember fondly from back in the day. That one's Crash 3 Warped. This game is still a solid game with great looking graphics and a unique style, and overall it's still good for the time and for a quick play, but if you have to choose one of the Crash games, stick to either of the two PS1 sequels. Or Spyro. That game kicks ass.
Well guys, hope you enjoyed this review of Crash Bandicoot. A good game, but has quite a lot of shortcomings. Definitely did not age well as its sequels and some of its contemporaries. And next time, hopefully as soon as possible, I'll be going over a console that I have recently gotten, and I'm having so much fun with it, and that is the Game Boy Micro. So until next time guys, CyberNerd5000, signing off.